How to design a system that can handle as many users as possible? Questions like this not only appear in job interviews, but also critical to our day-to-day programming tasks. Because none of us wants the midnight call from our boss saying that the system just crashed because your code could not handle a few extra customers. No, we do not want that. What we want is a solution that can bring us a peace of mind or to ace the interview. In this video, I will not only explain this solution, but also show the source code to you. Before we dive into the solution, let's try to understand where the real challenges are of this issue. The real issue is not that we have many users. It is because we have to deal two challenging problems at once. First, we need to deal with the unpredictable customer traffic spikes that can bring 10 times more traffic than usual. Second, we only have limited resources to handle those spikes. The question is, can we design a system that can handle those spikes with very small amount of resources? The answer is yes. Actually, we can learn the solution from the banking industry. Banks, they also face similar problems. A large number of customers can unpredictably bring traffic spikes. Spikes that can cause 10 times more traffic than usual. And they have a limited number of tailors to serve all customers. Their solution? They ask all customers waiting in a queue, and they have a small number of tailors to serve all of them. All tailors select the next customers from the end of the queue. Each tailor only serves one customer at a time. When the queue becomes empty, all tailors have to be idling, waiting for new customers to come. When new customers come, they resume their services. The key idea of this model is to use a queue to absorb the traffic spikes. The spikes can only cause the queue to grow, but the service remains the same under the same number of tailors. The software industry borrowed this idea and invented a design pattern called the leader and followers. The core of this design pattern is a queue and a thread pool. All customer requests are pushed into the queue, and our tailors, a group of threads running in a thread pool, process all those requests. Each thread takes one request from the queue, processes it, and then loops back for more requests until the queue is empty. If the queue is empty, threads go to sleep mode until new requests wake them up. This pattern allows the system to manage the spikes with a small number of threads. Now you understand the high-level concepts of this design pattern. Let's see how we implement it in our code. The code simulates a situation where many customers want to withdraw or deposit money at a bank. Our code implements the leader and the followers design pattern with a thread pool and a thread-safe queue. We demonstrate this within a function called testLeaderFollower. Within this function, we create queue first, and then we create a thread pool with three threads running inside. And then we create 10 different tasks and put them all in the queue. At the other end of the queue, threads in the thread pool will process those tasks. And then we generate a special task, a terminate task, and put it into the queue so that we can notify the thread pool it's time to wrap up. All threads must be terminated. A critical part of this pattern is the queue. The queue is thread-safe, meaning all functions of this queue can run safely in a multi-threading environment. For example, the inQueue function, which allows threads to add a task into the queue, and the dequeue function, which allows threads to remove a task from the queue, can all work safely in a multi-threading environment. How to write a thread-safe queue? we need to implement three things. First, we need to use a mutex to protect the queue. At any point of time, the mutex only allows one thread to access a queue. And the second, when the queue is empty, the dequeue function won't return, and this will cause all waiting threads to go to sleep. Third, when a new task comes to an empty queue, the queue only wakes up one thread. If you want to know more about thread-safe message queue, you can watch this video. I will put the link below. Then, what is a task in the queue? A task consists of two parts. The first is information it carries. In this case, it's the money and the task stream. And the second, it's a function that will be executed by the processing thread in the thread pool. In this case, it's our execute task function. This function just simply prints out the task message. Now let's move to the thread pool. A thread pool has three data members. The limit, which defines how many threads will be running in the thread pool. A vector variable, worker thread, which hosts all threads running in the thread pool. And the message queue reference that queues all tasks in the queue. In our example, the queue we just created in the test leader follower function. When thread pool is created, it creates the underscore limit number of thread objects in the constructor, and then push them into the worker thread vector. We will use this vector to manage the threads. When we create each thread object, we pass the member function execute task into the thread. The execute task works exactly like a teller in a bank. The entire function is in an endless loop. Within each loop, the function calls the dequeue function to take out the next task from the queue and execute the task by calling the task's execute task function. Because the queue is thread-safe, the dequeue function won't return unless there are tasks in the queue. If the task is a terminate task, then the function returns to terminate the thread. But before its return, the thread requeues the terminate task to give other threads a chance to terminate. This is necessary because one terminated task can only notify one thread. To terminate other threads, the terminating thread must relay the terminated task to the next waiting thread. And the next thread will relay the terminating task again to notify a new waiting thread. That's all the code. If you compare our thread pool version against others on the internet, you would find it's much simpler. In our design, we don't need to worry about mutex, condition variables, spurious wakeup, those headaches. How? Because we separate our responsibilities into two classes, the pool and the queue. A lot of other designs, they mixed the queue right into the pool, and believe me, that's a recipe for a lot of more complexity. If you want to discuss concepts like this with other developers, I invite you to join our free community. I leave the information below. If you want to systematically upgrade your skills in software design field, take a look at my software architecture design course where I teach use different design patterns to do system design. I leave the details below. Now let's run our code and see the results. And let's run it. At the beginning of this program, all threads in the thread pool are waiting for the empty queue. They are blocked. Once there are tasks in the queue, threads in the pool started processing those tasks. These lines are the processing results. And because the processing threads moved faster than the in-queue rate, so sometimes the queue could be empty again. And if this happened, and you can see some threads will be blocked again, until new messages or tasks come into the queue, and they continue to process. Once the bank is closed and the terminated task is sent out into the queue, and because the thread relays the terminated task one by one, that's why you see all three threads print out that they are terminating. That means all three threads in the pool shut down properly. It's finally done, Jesus. I finally finished all the videos for the multi-threading design pattern series. I will put the link to the source code down below so that you can use them in your projects. Actually, I've been thinking of sharing these ideas of the patterns and the source code since like 10 years ago. Why? Because people around me keep telling me that the multi-threading programming is hard, it's very difficult to debug. Yes, I agree. But my experience is that if you understand these patterns, it's actually very hard for you to make mistakes. I don't remember when was my last time that my multi-threading code caused some production errors. So is that useful? And in fact, later on, those patterns have become the backbone for those systems I was involved in design, systems that can sustain hundreds of million users in China. So I hope these patterns and source code can help you. So if you have some thoughts, please leave them in the comment areas. And if you find bugs in the source code, that's even better. Please let me know so that we can improve on it and other people can benefit from it. Yeah, that's it. I hope to see you in my next video. Thanks.